Scaling Up Benji is a national nonprofit organization that started right next door in Ames, Iowa. I founded it when I was 21 years old because there's a need for education on puppy mills. In the last 8 years, we have expanded 22 states across the country, and we are educating every single day about puppy mills. And we're providing the transparency to the puppy mill industry and the pet store industry that the government will not. Many of us that are in the know when it comes to puppy mills know that a lot of redaction has happened when it comes to USDA reports in the last few years. Thanks to Mary Got Benji and my volunteers, we've been able to help expose all of that. So before I get too into it, I want to tell you why I got involved. When I was 19 years old, I was a homesick college student, and I went to my local pet store to play with the puppies. Who's been there? Admit it, it's okay. We've all gone into a pet store and caught puppies. And that was before we knew about puppy mills like we know now. So I was 19, away for the first time, away from my pets, and I decided to go to Petland, of course it was Petland, to play with those cute little puppies. And those employees are trained to put a puppy into your hand the minute you walk in the door. So they put this puppy in my hand, and they're like, oh, he's your baby, he loves you, you should take him home. And I was like, oh no, I can't, but thank you. And so I gave it back, and I came back the next day because you have to go back. I mean, I was like, it's gonna be on college day. So I went back, and I'm like, here's this puppy again. He's still here, oh look, he's licking your face, he loves you, you better take him home. And I was like, I'm so sorry, I don't have money, I'm 19, I'm a full-time college student, I cannot afford this $2,500 puppy. What do you think Petland did? Yes. They gave me a credit card. I was 19 years old, and they gave me a credit card with a 30% interest rate to buy a $2,500 dog. I mean, that right there should have been the end of Petland. That should not have been allowed to give me a credit card to do that. I was a 19-year-old adult, and I knew what I was doing, but I didn't know. And so on top of that price of that puppy, I had to buy and toys and food, and then of course take the dog to the vet. I had no idea what I was doing, signed my credit away, and off I went with my happy little puppy. Did I mention that they sold me a purebred Siberian Husky? Oh. So I was 19, full-time college student, had a full-time job, and I brought a very, very, very high-energy puppy into my apartment. That did not go well. He was amazing and I loved him, but he chewed up everything because no one told me. There was not one counselor at that pet store that said, you might not want this puppy. It might not be right for you. But what happened 2 weeks later is I was cuddling my little puppy on the couch and I was watching the news. And there was a news story on that pet named. And more importantly, they named the breeder that was on my dog's paperwork. And he was one of the worst puppy mills in the country. And my heart dropped. My jaw was on the floor, and I was crying because my puppy could be sick. My puppy might have a problem. I didn't stop to think for a second that my puppy's parents are still the puppy mill, or my puppy's grandparents or great-grandparents. So it was about 2 years later when I finally got the bigger picture and found that they might have puppy. So today, gosh, I'm so sorry I can't do that. We're going to be talking about all day, we're going to be talking about the puppy mill epidemic across the country. What you guys can do here in Illinois and what's really happening here in Illinois. Because we have two types of puppy mills, or two types of states. We have pet store states and we have puppy mill states. And we'll get into that as well. How many of you know what puppy mills are? Good. Don't really, I'm not going to go too deep into this, but puppy mills are commercial dog breeding facilities that produce hundreds of puppies without providing the care of the parent dogs. These parent dogs are living without vet care. They're living without healthy food, without clean water, and their whole existence is just to breed puppies. Those breeder dogs will never find homes unless people like us rescue them. And so that's a pretty, pretty unfortunate existence for these animals. Unfortunately, with our complete I want it now society, puppy mills are more in demand now than ever. You can walk into a pet store and get a puppy today. You can buy a puppy from a website and they'll ship it to you tomorrow. You can go on Craigslist, on Facebook. Puppy mills are everywhere. And it's up to us as advocates to stop that, which is why we're here today. Unfortunately, when you walk into your local pet store, they're going to tell you, we don't use puppy mills. We never use puppy mills. We use local family breeders. They're USDA licensed. They're wonderful. But this is what USDA as long as the dog can stand up, turn around, and lay down, it's fine. And the USDA says that's okay. So that eagle that I mentioned earlier could live in an oven-sized cage the rest of its life. Is that humane?
No.
No, it's not. And regular breeders wouldn't treat their dogs that way. This is a fact that puppy mills are doing to their animals. When you start housing more than one dog in a kennel, the kennel size has to increase, and the USDA says that breeders can have up to 12 dogs in a kennel. Unfortunately, we see when combing through these inspection reports, they're not even providing adequate size a lot of the time. We see violations where the breeders are in trouble because the puppies themselves can't even stand up and have their ears not touched because of the cage. It's very important. When you start adding more dogs into cages, the cage size expands, and that can include their exercise space. So if the breeder provides any extra space in that kennel, that can be their exercise. And when we're speaking about exercise, they only need to have an exercise plan on paper. Never once do they have to prove to the USDA inspector that these animals are getting to be walked or getting to run out on the farm or any type of mental stimulation. It's not required. Mental stimulation inside puppy mills is not a required thing, which is why USDA license is one of the biggest red flags. The other thing is that there's no limit inside a puppy mill, no limit of dogs. So you can have a breeder that has 3 or 5 breeding dogs, and then you can have facilities with 10,000 breeding dogs. We have one that I know that has over 1,000 breeding dogs. There are several in Wisconsin that have 3,000 breeding dogs. This is a huge problem because we know logistically, even if they had the staff to take care of 3,000 dogs, they're not all getting walked every day, they're not getting cuddles every day. It's that bare minimum. You give them food, water, and they have a shelter, and that's all you need. And that leads me to talk about the age limit. Does anyone know the minimum age requirement for a dog to be bred in a puppy mill?
6 months.
6 months old. When the dog is going to its first heat cycle, which is around 6 months old, it can be bred inside a puppy mill. My own dog was rescued from a puppy mill at 18 months old. She'd already had 3 litters of puppies. And she's a black lab, so she was having 10 or 12 puppies in a litter. And by the time she was 18 months old and came to my home, she had never known a nice human. And never had made eye contact with a human that she wasn't scared of. So that getting her to rehab was so hard because she just didn't trust us. Because all she knew was that life in a cage and having her puppies taken away way too soon. And the last thing I want to touch on when it comes to the USDA is the fact that there are only 120 USDA inspectors in the entire country. There are 12,000 USDA facilities, and there are 120 inspectors. So these inspectors are overworked, but also they are not experts on dogs. When they walk into a breeding facility one day, they're making sure the dog has a clean kennel and the kennel is safe, and then the next day they're at a zoo, and then the next day they're at a testing facility. These inspectors are not experts. They literally walk in to make sure the cages are clean, and then they walk out. So that's why it's on us as advocates to create change. This is one of our maps that Amy and Benji puts out, and we basically try to educate about being graphic. A lot of us don't want to see the sad photos. We don't want to see the sad videos. It works for some people, but I love maps and facts and data. And so this map right here is kind of hard to see, but it is on our website. You can see that these dark, dark blue states are the puppy mill belt. Iowa, Missouri, Kansas, Nebraska, Indiana, Ohio. This is the puppy mill belt because we have a high volume of agricultural breeders, commercial dog breeders. Unfortunately, when you look at Iowa and Nebraska and Missouri, because we have these high volume cattle farms and hog farms, it's hard for us to pass any kind of legislation on the state level to protect these dogs. Because I'm sure many of us that have fought for puppy mill dogs for years have heard, laws for dogs trickle down to hogs. And no one wants to pass a law for a commercial dog breeder because next year we might go out for the hog farmers. And this is why you can really see where our problem is in this country. always this little mix of puppy mill state and pesto state. So we have a different enemy here. We have more animosity here because it's both sides of that coin. Down here, as we get more towards the middle of Illinois, we're seeing a lot of puppy mills, and a lot of those are Amish puppy mills. So again, if you go to our website, you can see all of this, and you can actually see the names of a lot of these puppy mills and the pet stores. So this is a wonderful graphic made by the Humane Society of the United States, and it shows you that by the time that illegal puppy goes to your home, it's already exchanged hands at least three times. So picture this, you're a little baby puppy, and you're born in a puppy mill, and you only know your life next to your scared mother in a cage. And then one day, a noisy truck pulls up, and the truck swoops you up with a ton of other puppies, and then you drive somewhere. This truck is what's known as a broker, and this is kind of one of the hidden puzzle pieces of the puppy mill world. A lot of people don't realize that there's a whole other business that exists just to pick puppies at the pet stores and ship them, pick puppies at the puppy mills and ship them to pet stores. And so these brokers are middlemen. And often they have hundreds of puppies in their van or in the back of their semi-truck. And they're transporting them from Iowa, from Illinois, all the way down to Florida. That's 36 hours, 40 hours in the back of the semi, from the back of the transport. Legally, the driver has to get out and rest. The driver has to go sleep. He can't drive for 36 hours straight. So those puppies are left in the van overnight. The puppies are defecating on themselves, they're vomiting because it's the first time they've ever been in a vehicle or in a car sick. By the time they finally get to that pet store, usually they're filthy. And most pet store employees will tell you that. The dogs come in filthy. They have feces, urine, and vomit all over them. So again, that's the third hand that's touching by the time they get to that pet store. Then they get cleaned up and sold to the consumer. The consumer has no idea what happened prior to that puppy hitting that pet store cage. What they think is, they're buying a puppy, it's a clean slate. I have a baby puppy and I can train it and I can do everything I want with it, but they don't realize that that puppy has already had three homes before it hit that pet store. One of the things my nonprofit loves to say is, puppies in the store walk out the door. If there's a pet store in your community that is selling puppies, don't buy dog food there, don't buy leashes, don't give them any of your money because you're voting with your money every single time you shop. Even if you go in and you're like me and you want to cover those baby puppies because that's life and we all love puppies, what we're really showing the pet store owners is that there's a demand for those puppies. Every time you walk into that store, they see dollar signs. They don't see customers, they see dollar signs. They want to know how they can sell you that puppy. And they're going to work on it and they're going to make sure you walk out with a puppy. Whether or not you want it just for dog food, they'll make sure you get it. The other side of this, now that we're in that I want it now Amazon culture stage, is online puppy sales. And so one of the ways we combat that is saying, show me the money. If you're going to buy a dog and you truly, truly want a purebred and you don't want to go to rescue, do your research. Google the breeder. Show me the money. Go to the facility and meet the parent dogs. Because that's how you know you're not supporting a puppy mill. That's one of the easiest ways. These three websites right here, Next Day Pets, Puppy Find, and Puppy Spot, your veterinarian needs to sign off on a piece of paper that says the dog is healthy. They don't do any tests, they just say that he knows to be healthy. This is the same in breeding facilities. And so I track hundreds of thousands of puppies leaving Iowa, Illinois, Nebraska, Missouri to the pet stores all over the country. And if you go to our website, you can see that. And we do have all of the Illinois stores listed, and you can see exactly where Illinois pet stores are getting their puppies from. The best part about this is our website gets 3,000 views a day from people Googling breeders and Googling pet stores because they're trying to get more information. So the more information we can get out there and keep talking about, the more the public can do their research. And that's the most important thing. Because when we're informed consumers, when we know what we're buying, then we can also avoid those scare tactics and the shady business practices. So the top words you can't see are problems with pet store puppies. And a lot of this is puppies are sick when they're coming from these facilities. When you're a 19-year-old college student and you've already got a credit card to pay for this dog, and then all of a sudden it's sick, you cannot pay for that. So what do I do? What do I do with my sick puppy? I have to take it to a rescue or shelter. I have to dump it off somewhere because I can't take care of it, right? We all, as rescue and shelter operators, we know that we get a lot of sick animals in because families can afford their pet. So I'm gonna give you two examples as someone who walks into a pet store. On one hand, you walk in and you see that cute little sleepy puppy and it kind of gives you slow little licks and you're so excited, so you buy it and take it home. And that puppy never gets its energy. And the pet store said, no, no, it's just sleepy, it's fine, it's okay. But the puppy's not waking up, it's not excited to see you, it doesn't have puppy energy, so you take it to the vet. And it's got parvo, or it's got coccidia, or chlamydia. All these are very common pet store issues. So this little puppy that you thought you bought was healthy at the store is now sick and at a vet clinic, getting emergency vet care. When you trace that puppy back to the puppy mill, where it was sick at the puppy home, then it arrived in the transport van, it got 100 other puppies and that transport van was sick with parvo or exposed to parvo. And then that transport van drops off puppies to 10 different pet stores and all of those pet stores have been infected or exposed to parvo. And it's a highly contagious disease. So that's option one. You know, you go to the pet store and buy an immediately sick puppy. The second option is when you walk in and you buy a healthy puppy. And you've got 2 to 3 years where this puppy is amazing and healthy, and then you notice it's limping a little bit, and its back knees are giving out. So you take it to the vet, and it's got stage 4 luxating patellas. It's got a knee issue that was genetic and passed down from the families. You had no idea that was a thing. Your dog is only 3 years old. Why is it this sick? Again, it's traced back to that puppy mill, and the fact that these puppy mills don't have to genetically test their dogs. They don't have to make sure those dogs are healthy before they're breeding them and pumping puppies. There are also two diseases that have come out lately that are transferable to humans. And I'm assuming Mark's going to talk a little about Campylobacter later. Awesome. So I'm going to talk about the brucellosis outbreak that just happened in Iowa. And what happened was, a puppy mill decided to go out of business. Before you applaud, when puppy mills go out of business, they don't have to give their dogs to rescues or shelters. And this puppy mill is one of the worst in the country. Loads of violations. The USDA knew they were a problem breeder, but they let them go out of business and auction off all their dogs. So these public auctions, people in the public are there, rescues, shelters, and other breeders are there. And they sat in the audience and they bought dogs at the highest bidder. The highest bidder got every single dog. Many of them went to rescue that day. Many of them were sold just to the general public. They were like, oh, there's a puppy sale, I'm gonna go. What we found out a week later was all of those dogs tested positive for brucellosis, which is an STD that is passed around breeding facilities. It is also on cattle farms. This is one of the only diseases that can be passed to humans as well, and it's very hard to treat once it's inside the humans. With the Campylobacter outbreak, which they're gonna talk about later, people got sick from going into pet stores and playing with puppies, and it was an antibiotic-resistant strain. Once they were sick and at the hospital, antibiotics weren't fixing it. So there are a lot of issues with this, but the most of it is consumer protection. If we separate the fact that we love those dogs and puppy mills, and we really want to help those dogs and puppy mills, and we focus on the consumer protection aspect of this, we're going to create really big change locally. Because DuPage County doesn't want their constituents buying sick dogs. They don't want their constituents going broke because they bought a pet store, puppy mill, credit card. Or the newest thing is you can lease a dog like you lease a car. to make sure you walk out with that dog. And once you walk out with it, they don't care anymore, because there's another puppy to fill that cage, and then there's another customer that's going to buy it. On that very, very, very depressing note, I want to tell you guys that everybody can do something. And I want to point to this picture at the top. We're all protesting and it's raining. How many of you protest at that store here? Yay, I love seeing them. So when I moved to Ames, Iowa, there was a pet store in my town that was selling puppies. And I went in and I said, "Hey Dale, where do you get your puppies from?" And at this time, no one had ever questioned that. So he gave me the breeder card. He's like, "This is where we get our dogs from. If you want to call them, go ahead." I looked them up on the USDA's website. They had 400 adult breeding dogs on the property. So I decided to make an appointment, and I was 21 at the time that I lived young, so I just said I was buying my first puppy. He assumed that I was in college. And so I go to go look at the puppies that's not buying. And he shows me this row of 20 dogs, 20 white, fluffy, very pretty dogs. He's like, "Here's our mamas." I was like, "Okay, are there any other dogs here?" "Oh, no, 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 we don't have any other dogs." And in my head, I knew that there were 400 dogs on this property. So I'm looking at all these farm buildings, and I'm like, "Oh, well, what's in that one?" "Oh, honey, those are the honeymoon suites. You don't want to go in there. It's too romantic in there." That's where all the dogs were. He showed me the row of 20, and neglected to show me the 380 left in the farms. So I run back to the pet store. I'm like, "Dale, did you know? Here's all these USDA reports. Like, did you know this was going on?" And he said to me, and I quote, "You silly little girl. I've been using them for 30 years. Get out of this store." And I said, "I will be leaving, but I'm not done with you." I tried to get them to go humane. I tried to get the city, like citizens, to talk to him about going humane. Nothing worked. I protested him every single Saturday and Sunday for 6.5 years in -40-degree temperatures in the winter, 110-degree temperatures in the summer. We didn't take a break because those dogs back at the puppy mill don't ever get breaks. We protested it for 6.5 years until we closed it. And that's how I was able to create a change in my community. This one pet store refused to go humane, and now he's no longer in business. But there are plenty of other ways. You can do tabling events. You can set up an event at your local rescue or shelter adoption event and just educate people about puppies. You can hang up flyers in your favorite coffee shop around your local university. All of this is free on our website. You can go straight to bailingoutbenji.com. You can print Illinois-specific flyers. I also have some over there that you can grab and take with you. Hang those up, educating your community, because at the end of the day, I'm nobody. I'm telling you guys everything that I know, but until you go home and tell the people that you know, it all falls on deaf ears, because we're all already like-minded individuals. And if I tell you something, you can go home and tell your mom, or tell your kids, or tell your coworkers, and the more people we educate, the quicker we're going to shut down this problem. And I want to leave you with an upcoming boot camp. I know we're going to get out of film today, but if anybody wants to, you can come to Wheaton and a boot camp that we're hosting in Kansas City. It's the HSUS and Bailing Out Benji, and it's a 3-day boot camp that really, really goes into this. Today we have wonderful guest speakers, and I'm so glad everybody can come. But we also have this huge boot camp that's happening in Kansas City, and there are flyers on the back table. And on the back table, we also have shelter kits. So if you're in the shelter rescue business that wants to help us, we provide a laminated puppy mill map for Illinois, free flyers and free brochures, so you can, you know, hang them up in your community. And then all we ask is, if you're putting it to good use, snap a photo and tag us on Facebook so we can share and show everybody that the best groups are the ones that work together. The best groups, the best people are the ones that collaborate and share